Good morning to everyone, Chairman Sir. My topic is on perioperative management of cardiac conditions. Many patients who undergo non-cardiac surgery have an increased risk of developing a major adverse cardiac event in terms of perioperative myocardial infarction or cardiac death. Actually, cardiac complications are responsible for about half of the perioperative mortality. And 1 to 5% of cardiac mortality in patients who undergo vascular surgery is observed. So this is an important complication to consider during perioperative period. The objective of doing perioperative risk assessment includes evaluation of the patient's current medical status and also assessing the cardiac risk profile of the patient, management of cardiac risk during the perioperative period, treatment of modifiable factors such as hypertension, diabetes, and so on, and improve the clinical safety and reduce cardiac mortality and morbidity during the perioperative period. This is a teamwork. Of course, the patient and the family and the general practitioner should be involved. The surgical team, that includes the surgeon and the anesthesiologist and perhaps the intensivist, should be involved. And during the perioperative assessment, the specialist physician also involved and can play a major role in identifying the risk and management of these cardiac condition during the perioperative period. Of course, many other people, that includes the nursing staff, the physiotherapist for early mobilization. The role of the physician in this scenario includes reviewing the available patient data, taking a good history and thorough examination, determining if further help is needed to define cardiovascular status, recommendation of treatment to improve the medical conditions, and recommend preoperative testing that should be decided only if that will change the surgical care and perioperative medical therapy. Now, our clinical evaluation should include identification of serious cardiac conditions such as significant coronary artery disease, heart failure, severe valve disease. We'll discuss all these in a moment, and arrhythmias. Also, determining the severity and the stability of the disease condition and the prior treatment. Assessment of functional capacity is very important. Age of the patient, comorbid conditions such as diabetes, peripheral vascular disease, renal dysfunction, and pulmonary disease, and also the type of the surgery, especially the urgency of surgery, whether it's an urgent surgery or an elective surgery, and of the risk of the surgery, such as high-risk surgeries like valvular procedures, prolonged and complicated thoracic abdominal surgeries, and head and neck surgeries. We'll discuss each one of these next. Now, these are the risk factors for perioperative major cardiac events. That includes reduced functional capacity. We'll discuss what the functional capacity, how the functional capacity is determined. Ischemic heart disease, heart failure, cardiomyopathies, severe valve disease, especially severe aortic stenosis and severe mitral stenosis, significant arrhythmia such as AV conduction blocks and also ventricular arrhythmias, chronic renal failure, history of CV and transient ischemic attacks, diabetes who are on insulin, chronic pulmonary disease, obesity, and anemia. These are the major clinical predictors of cardiac risk. The patients who are having unstable coronary syndromes, such as recent myocardial infarction with post-infarction angina, unstable angina, or severe chronic stable angina, that is of CCS class 3 and 4. People who have decompensated heart failure, significant arrhythmias, as I mentioned before, AV blocks and also symptomatic ventricular tachyarrhythmias. Severe valve disease are also categorized into major predictors of cardiac risk. Then intermediate predictors include mild angina pectoris of class 1 to 2, history of myocardial infarction detected by the history or pathological QAS in ECG, compensated heart failure or history of heart failure, diabetes mellitus. Minor risk predictors include at the advanced age, abnormal ECG findings such as LVH, left bundle branch block or ST abnormalities, rhythms other than sinus rhythm such as atrial fibrillation, low functional capacity that is less than 4 metabolic equivalents, history of stroke and uncontrolled hypertension. This is how the functional capacity can be assessed by METS. We can take a good history and assess the functional capacity of the patient in the ward setting or in a clinic. Or else, we'll discuss later, we can do an exercise ECG where you can actually measure the METS objectively. Up to 4 or less than 4 METS is considered as poor functional capacity. 4 to 10 is moderate, and more than 10 or more METS, if you can do during day-to-day activities, is considered as having a very good functional capacity. Now, according to the surgery, also we can assess the risk of cardiac events. The people who undergo high-risk surgeries, like cardiac risk more than 5%, are emergency major operations, particularly in elderly, aortic and other vascular surgeries, peripheral vascular surgeries, and surgeries where the anticipated prolonged procedures associated with large fluid shifts or blood loss. The intermediate risk surgeries, that is the risk of cardiac events between 1 to 5% include carotid endarterectomies, head and neck surgeries, intraperitoneal and intrathoracic surgeries, orthopedic and prostatic surgeries. The low-risk surgeries are the endoscopic procedures, cataract and breast surgeries, and other superficial surgeries. Now, in order to calculate the overall risk of cardiovascular events, there has been several published risk assessment methods. I don't want to go through all these, but it actually started in 1977 by Goldman's landmark publication, but that was modified by Desky and others later on. And many of the recommendations I am going to discuss today are from ACC and AHA guidelines, which was first published in 1996 and later updated in 2002 and 2014. What is important in the clinical practice is actually the last three, the publication of revised cardiac risk assessment index by Lee in 1999, and also these National Surgical Quality Improvement Program calculators by Gupta and later their updates. Now, this is what many people practice because it is easy to practice and it is very reliable. In Lee's revised cardiac risk index, they go by 6 independent risk factors. They are the risk of the surgery, history of coronary artery disease, history of congestive heart failure, history of cerebrovascular disease, diabetes who are on insulin, and preoperative serum creatinine of more than 2 milligrams per deciliter. So if all the factors are given equal weight and the score is calculated, If the score is zero, that is the lowest risk category, the cardiac event rate is 0.4%. And if 1.9%, 2 is 6%, and more than 3, 3 or more is 11%. Now, these figures also change time to time and change it with each meta-analysis. But however, this is a very useful tool for the day-to-day practice. The other one is, as I said, the National Surgical Quality Improvement Program, Myocardial Infarction Cardiac Arrest Calculator, where they use other parameters, type of surgery, functional status, creatinine concentration, ASA physical status classification, and age. Now, in the previous LEAS index, the age was not considered. And some think that this model has a better discrimination over the revised cardiac index. The NSQIP surgical risk calculator is an online calculator like the STS calculator for cardiac surgery. And this is for the non-cardiac surgery where 21 specific patient-specific variables are used and calculate the risk of myocardial infarction and cardiac arrest during perioperative period. So we can use either of these to assess the risk and discuss with the surgical team and the family at the time of the surgery. So this is an objective measurement of the risk. Now, the big question is, what should we do when a patient comes? Now, because all depends on the risk of the patient as well as the urgency and the requirement of the surgery. If it is a life-threatening emergency and the surgery, urgent surgery is essential to save the life, we have no choice but to go ahead with the surgery. We have to take all the precautions during the surgery and during the post-operative period. We have to discuss with this with the surgical team and the family and explain to them. If the patient is having ongoing acute cardiac event like myocardial infarction or decompensated heart failure, some significant arrhythmia, or else patient is having hemodynamically compromised valvular lesions, again, we have to manage those conditions as per the guidelines and then consider them for surgery if they can wait for the treatment. If the risk is minor and the patient also has low risk and going for low risk surgery, patient does not need any further evaluation, they can go for surgery. Otherwise, we can assess their functional capacity. If the meds are more than 4 and the patient is asymptomatic, again, we can consider them for surgery. So initial steps are very easy. Within few minutes of evaluation of the patient, we can decide. However, the outcomes may be vary. The problem comes if the functional capacity is also poor, they are going for elective surgery and has several risk factors. Then if they have more than risk, 3 risk factors and going for high risk surgery or more than 3 risk factors going for intermediate surgery, you have to evaluate. Actually, the step 5 in this diagram are the patients who need real pre-operative risk assessment and evaluation with other investigations. These are the methods we can use: history and examination, ECG, echocardiography, stress ECG, pharmacological stress testing, ambulatory ECG monitoring, that's Holter, and coronary angiography. We'll briefly discuss how we do that. Of course, as physicians, we always have to do the objective examination and taking measurements like heart rate, blood pressure, respiratory rate, temperature, saturation, height, weight, and the body mass index. And especially to assess the cardiac risk, to identify any active cardiac problems, it's important to find out whether there is third or fourth heart sounds, pulmonary crepitations, elevated JVP, ascites, hepatomegaly, dependent edema, and also the patient, whether the patient has murmurs suggestive of hemodynamically significant valve disease. Now, almost everyone get a preoperative ECG. However, the guidelines say to if the patient is of intermediate to high risk, going for intermediate to high risk surgery to get that. Draw the attention to the fourth line. Preoperative ECG is not recommended for patients who are not having risk factors and also going scheduled for low risk surgery. But most of the patients include in the first three categories and should have at least an ECG for cardiovascular risk assessment. Now, echocardiography is another common investigation we do. Actually, we do echocardiography to assess the LV functions as well as to assess the valve functions, including other structural heart diseases. Now, it is indicated if the patient has dyspnea of unknown etiology and also a patient with a history of heart failure with worsening dyspnea or other changes in clinical status in the recent past, or else even the patients who have history of heart failure with no echocardiogram done during last 1 year. Others, the routine preoperative evaluation with echocardiography to assess the LV functions is not recommended. In terms of valvular functions, if we hear a murmur, which is suggestive of moderate or severe stenosis or regurgitation with no echocardiogram done during the last 1 year or significant change in the clinical status since the last evaluation, we should do an echocardiogram. Exercise testing is not commonly done in our country. However, this is a very useful tool because it gives us evidence of inducible ischemia and also can assess the functional capacity, as I mentioned before, and not only the evidence, but also the severity of ischemia and the hemodynamic stability during stress in terms of hemodynamic and electrical stability. Exercise stress testing is indicated in patients who have poor functional capacity or unknown functional capacity if they have high risk or intermediate risk factors. And also, intermediate to high risk patients with poor functional capacity, we can do exercise ECG to assess the evidence of myocardial ischemia. And all these are done if we can do something either medically or by an intervention to improve the situation before the surgery. Pharmacological stress testing is also important, especially for the people who can't exercise. We can do dobutamine stress echo and also nuclear perfusion imaging with dipyridamole adenosine stress. We can do this especially in people, high-risk people with poor functional capacity to assess evidence of inducible ischemia. Now, coronary angiography is not commonly done before surgeries, but especially in the patients who are very high risk and going for high risk surgeries, and angina and unresponsive for adequate medical therapy, unstable angina, and also high risk patients going for high risk surgeries with unequivocal non-invasive test results should be considered for coronary angiography if facilities available. But there are class 2 recommendations, mostly especially the patients who are going for high risk surgeries and they when they have intermediate to high risk factors. Especially the people who demonstrate large areas of ischemia on non-invasive imaging or by exercise testing should be considered for coronary angiography. However, all these testing should be considered if we can go ahead with some treatment, some management plan to change the situation of the patient and to reduce the cardiac risk at the perioperative period. There are some class 3 recommendations where we should not consider coronary angiography before surgery. Those are the low-risk patients going for non-cardiac surgery and no high risk results from the non-invasive testing when the people have asymptomatic people have good functional capacity. Those sort of patients should not be considered. And also very severe patients where we don't consider coronary revascularization, especially when they have severe left ventricle dysfunction, or if they are refusing to undergo revascularization, should not be considered. One controversial point is that candidates who undergo liver, lung, or renal transplantation, whether we should consider them for coronary angiography routinely. Now, various transplant programs include this as an investigation. Like in other countries, after 50 years or when they have diabetes more than 10 years, should routinely get an angiogram before it. But the guidelines says it should not be done before these transplant surgeries. Now, perioperative management, I will discuss briefly because Dr. Ganaka Senaratne discussed this in detail. However, severe hypertension, especially when the blood pressure is more than 180 systolic and diastolic 110, should be controlled before the surgery when possible. And if the patient is on antihypertensives and the blood pressure is adequately controlled, they should be continued. Now, various studies have shown different results, and it's a bit confusing when you look at the literature. However, the guidelines say the continuation of ACE inhibitors and ARBs are reasonable, especially if they are given for purpose like heart failure, and should be continued cautiously during the surgical operative period. However, if they are stopped preoperatively, they should be restarted as soon as possible after the surgery. Symptomatic stenotic lesions such as mitral stenosis and aortic stenosis who are going undergoing high-risk surgery and who are likely to develop perioperative shock because of the valvular lesion should be considered for percutaneous valvotomy or replacement to lower the cardiac risk before the surgery. But symptomatic regurgitant lesions rarely give rise to problems and they are better tolerated. They can be stabilized with medical therapy before the surgery. However, all these patients with significant valvular problems should be monitored very closely during the intraoperative and postoperative period when they undergo, especially when they undergo intermediate and high risk surgery. The people with arrhythmias, we have to investigate and see whether there is any structural or metabolic reason for the arrhythmia, such as electrolyte imbalances and also drug toxicities. They should be corrected before the surgery and you prevent the risk of developing arrhythmia during the perioperative period. Especially people who are on pacemakers and ICDs, we need to contact the cardiac team and inform them that so-and-so is undergoing the surgery, especially if you are planning to use the diathermy. And oftentimes, we can inactivate the device. However, if you inactivate the device, the meticulous cardiac monitoring should be done during the entire period of inactivation, and CPR facilities and external defibrillation should be readily available to resuscitate the patient if they develop a tachyarrhythmia. Coronary artery disease and heart failure medication should be continued. The beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, nitrates should be continued during the intraoperative and postoperative period. The medications given for pulmonary hypertension and right heart failure also should be continued unless they are contraindicated or not tolerated by the patient. Now, perioperative beta blocker therapy, again, this is very confusing in the literature. Different trials, different randomized control trials also have given different results, as Dr. Ganaka Senaratne described in the POISE trial. It gives adverse outcomes when you use beta blockers during therapy. However, the guidelines say beta blockers should be continued perioperatively in patients who take these medications long term. If they are already on beta blockers, they should be continued. And also, it is reasonable to start perioperative beta blockers in intermediate to high risk patients for myocardial ischemia noted during restratification, especially if the exercise ECG is positive and not going for revascularization and so on, should be on beta blockers. And the heart failure patient should be on beta blockers at the time they go for surgery. The issue is when we should start beta blockers. Ideally, as Dr. Ganakara Senaratne quite rightly described, beta blockers should be started at least one day before the surgery to assess the safety and tolerability. They should not be started on the day of the surgery. Statins should be continued perioperatively if they are already on those medications. And also they should be considered as treatment if the statin guidelines, therapy for statin guidelines indicates for high-risk patients. And also especially when they undergo vascular surgery, such as carotid surgery, statins are indicated to be started at the time of the surgery. Antiplatelet agents was well described by Professor Lalendra Gunaratne. However, especially if the patient had balloon angioplasty or stent deployment, either bare metal stent or drug guillotine stents, they should be continued. The issue is patients going for urgent surgeries within first 4 to 6 weeks after the interventional procedure. Now, if this is done within the first 6 weeks, we encourage to continue dual antiplatelet therapy and assess the risk of bleeding and the stent thrombosis. If the risk of stent thrombosis is more than the risk of bleeding, we should continue with the antiplatelet therapy during that period, the dual antiplatelets. And many other patients, high-risk patients going for elective non-cardiac surgeries can be on aspirin at the time of surgery. Again, as Professor Lalinda said, the risk of bleeding and risk of thrombosis should be assessed. If the risk of bleeding is lesser than the risk of thrombosis, the aspirin should be continued. In all the other patients, antiplatelet therapy should be held, and he gave you the different time periods before the surgery. Bypass surgery or stenting, there are no randomized clinical trials to document decreased incidence of perioperative cardiac events by doing these procedures. However, if the coronary anatomy suggests prognostic lesions that can improve the survival of these patients by doing the revascularization, we should consider them before the surgery. However, coronary revascularization is not recommended before non-cardiac surgery, exclusively to prevent perioperative cardiac risk. Perioperative PCI also the same, no randomized trials to show a benefit to reduce cardiac events. And when it is done, elective non-cardiac surgery should be delayed for 14 days after balloon angioplasty, 30 days after bare metal stents, and 6 to 12 months after drug guillotine stent placement. Anesthetic considerations, there's no one best myocardial protective anesthetic technique. To my knowledge, our anesthesia colleague will have their opinions. Opioids, when used, they are good for cardiovascular stability, but they may need post-operative ventilation. And inhalational agents can cause myocardial depression, and neuraxial blocks can cause sympathetic blockage. Especially low-level ones are okay with minimal hemodynamic change, but when they are used for abdominal operations, can cause profound effects by causing hypotension and reflex tachycardia. Perioperative pain management is very important, especially Patient controlled analgesia can be administered either intravenously or epidural to reduction of pain. They reduce the postoperative catecholamine surge and hypercoagulability, and in terms of that, it will reduce the myocardial ischemia. Intraoperative nitroglycerin may be helpful, but sometimes it can cause vasodilatation together with other anesthetic agents and may cause significant hypotension and even myocardial ischemia. Intraoperative monitoring is very important to reduce cardiovascular events. Nowadays, in major surgeries, high-risk surgeries, perioperative transesophageal echocardiography is done, and it is useful in patients with hemodynamic instability for the monitoring. Pulmonary artery catheters are also placed for monitoring of pulmonary artery pressure, and they may be considered in patients who have cardiac conditions that significantly affects hemodynamics, like recent myocardial infarctions, decompensated heart failure, severe valvular disease, and so on. Also, maintenance of normothermia may be reasonable to reduce perioperative cardiac events in patients undergoing cardiac surgery. Now, perioperative surveillance of myocardial infarctions, the best is to go by the clinical symptoms postoperatively. And also, if there are symptoms or ECG changes, we can check the cardiac markers such as CKMB, troponins, and CKMB isoforms. One cost-effective method is to do an ECG at baseline immediately after surgery and the first two postoperative days and compare these ECGs, especially in the high-risk patients. Routine use of cardiac enzymes are not advised unless the patient has either clinical or ECG evidence of or hemodynamic evidence of ischemia. Another way is intraoperative and postoperative ST monitoring. Is computerized ST segment analysis can be done and may improve the sensitivity of detection of myocardial ischemia. Intraoperative and postoperative ST segments are strong predictors in perioperative myocardial infarction. Lastly, this is a good opportunity for us to find out patients. They may be coming for a surgery that can be cured by doing the surgery, but these cardiac conditions and the risk factors can be first found out at the time of the surgery, and they should be monitored long term. And also, we have seen enough of patients who were diagnosed before and have stopped their treatment. They can be restarted and motivate the patients to continue the treatment to prevent long-term complications and cardiovascular events. Thank you.